It's time for 28mm World War II action. Will you recreate history or reshape it your way? On the Bolt Action Hub at beastsofwar.com. Become a general of mighty armies at the Kings of War Hub. Take command of elves, dwarves, and orcs in this game of masked fantasy combat on beastsofwar.com.
Hey everyone, welcome to another Weekender. It's good to be back on the show. I'm here with Justin and Ben. Of course, I'm Lloyd. I've had a little bit of a break.
Well, I wouldn't call it a break for the amount of work you've been doing off camera. Yes. You have been up to your eyeballs in code.
I've been beavering away on the campaign system that's up and running.
But, yeah.
You know, we've said lots and lots of stuff about that campaign. Let's get on and get stuck in today's show.
Okay.
Okay, guys. Yeah. First up, we'll cover some news.
Yeah, why not?
Okay. Sounds good.
Well, what's up first?
Ben? What have we got?
Okay, so the first thing up is a Frostgrave table that was designed by a couple of community members sort of out there on the social sphere, as it were. Yeah.
This is gorgeous.
Yeah, this is by Joe Wright, a.k.a. John Smith, and James Hammond. And this is their awesome Frostgrave table set within the ruins, and it features a really cool villa in the sky. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, it is actually suspended from the ceiling by ropes. With clouds underneath. It looks really awesome. I really like this, yeah.
You know what?
Absolutely awesome. I love this.
I'm digging that. Let me bring that picture back up. Look at that.
I'm loving it.
I really like the actual cotton wool bit to make it look like I'm a cloud.
Yeah.
Rather than just suspended. Because we've talked about making, you know, suspended islands and stuff. And I was thinking about dangling vines and stuff like that. But I hadn't really thought of just putting in a cloud. That's kind of a new look.
You know, you see, you went Avatar. They just went, you know what? Magic.
Yeah. Are they just doing this for love of the game, Ben? Is that what this is?
Yeah, they really love the game, so they developed a really awesome ruined city, but then they thought to take it an extra step higher, quite literally almost, and they went with the idea that there was teleportation pads around the city, and they could send you up into the villa where you had to go and fight to try and get the magical items and things. Mm. So it basically focuses all the fighting, but also has it on multiple layers as well, so you've got that added thing to it as well. Looks really good. I would love to make a table like this. It'd be fantastic.
It looks fun, but I'd be worried. I mean, like, we know Warren drops minis. Do we really want Warren playing at a table and then having to reach up higher above the table? No! He fell off the edge and he actually broke. No!
Yeah, it'd be a little bit like Age of Ultron where the huge landmass just falls.
Yeah. Do you know what strikes me about this Frostgrave though, right?
Yeah.
For something that's skirmish games, you don't take very many miniatures out.
Yeah.
It's really inspiring people to do really complicated table layouts and stuff.
Even in
our own club here, right? When people come in to play Frostgrave, they suddenly go, I'm gonna have this, I'm gonna have this, I'm gonna have
and
this.
Build some nice dense
and I'm gonna
tables.
Have this. Yeah, exactly. And then they play other games and I'm like, I don't put half the effort into that.
You see, Frostgrave is really one of those games you can build your own stories for this. This is open world fantasy wargaming. Go nuts, have fun. You know, that with them starting to add in the fantasy races, it's just going to blow up. So, for me personally, I love the game. I've already got my Dwarven Warband, and yes, there is a Dwarven Mage in there. He's a runesmith.
Well, that's some statement, Justin. It's going to blow up even after it took Best Miniatures game.
Well, hang on. Yes, it deserved it. It absolutely deserved it because it's allowing people to play their way.
Yeah.
Tell me I'm wrong.
I guess. One of the cool things, Ben, and you'll probably agree with me, is that a picture surfaced on the internet after the awards.
Yeah, so Dimitri Bermak, who does a lot of the art for the game itself, decided that he would celebrate the fact that the game won Best Miniatures Game in our awards. So he created this really nice piece of artwork, which you can see, which shows some of the wizards. Yeah, some of the wizards having a little bit of a party and getting to hold the trophy up and stuff like that. Really, really nice comic piece, this.
I love the necromancer.
Yeah.
He's on the left. He's just standing there going,
woohoo. Yeah, yay. He doesn't particularly want to be at the party, I think.
I agree with you. I love that hunch. Look, gosh.
Just like, can we just get on with it? We won. Can I get back to raising the dead now?
That's cool. Maybe we should be getting massive cups.
No.
What do you think, Justin?
Do. Yeah.
No. Well, hang on. Actually, we now have a smith. Because Ben went off and did his Dwarven adventure.
Right.
So, Ben, how do you fancy it? Do you want to smith up some Beast of War awards?
Well, considering I failed to make a knife, I don't think I could probably make goblets, but I could always give it a go, I guess. But, yeah.
Cool, cool stuff.
Very impressive.
Right, I'm going to move us on because I'm looking at my notes here and there's this next bit I really want to get on talking about. Dungeon Saga, the Infernal Crypts.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, guys, what's new? What are you going to tell me about this?
All right, this is the next stage of the adventure for the guys who are playing Dungeon Saga. So the very first one, yes, we were playing against the evil Lich Lord, but now we have a new evil overlord. So we're going to see new tactics, new monsters, and new parts of the dungeon. So new stories for your dungeon crawling adventuring party, and new heroes, I believe, Ben.
Nice.
Yeah? Yeah, so there's two new heroes that come within this set. You get Arianya, who's a naiad demon hunter, so sort of like a water-based creature, but she's a demon hunter, so
nice.
Awesome. So, yeah. And then we also have Venetia, who is or Venetia, who is a human cleric. Mm. So basically, two people who are hellbent on destroying abyssal creatures, and that's exactly what you get inside Infernal Crypts. You get loads of abyssal creatures. So,
nice.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of abyssal creatures, I have an image of them here.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Look at this.
Let's have a look at that.
So we have big, nasty fire elementals. We have Cerberus-type creatures. We have little red demons who are always fun. You know, it's a good time when I can. And then the actual components that you're getting in this set. So right here, you can see the new chart for the evil overlord. That's going to tell you how to fight and what the evil minions are going to do when they fight you.
Yeah.
You also have your new character cards in their different levels. I'm seeing new items, new spell cards.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm looking forward to this.
I'm really digging the fiery pits sort of
look to the game tiles. The actual game tiles.
I'm going to bring them back up again.
Well, you see, this is the thing. It's what I like about Mantic and them expanding this, because this actually comes in another one of their nice big tome boxes, which is really cool. So you know the way it's the book box.
Okay.
We have another one of those. You're just going to start loading out your bookshelves with these book boxes, which is just going to look so cool once you actually get them all together.
Ah, it's going to look
nice. Have a full library of games, effectively, then. Mm. So, yeah.
Well, literal games library. Yeah, why not?
Exactly, yeah.
Literally, yes. Right, moving on.
Yeah.
There's also new centaurs.
There's new forces of nature for Kings of War.
Even better.
Is what we're seeing. So, if I call this up... Sorry, I'm going to put you away for a second here, Ben.
That's all right.
All right, so we've got the melee centaurs for the forces of nature, but we've also got the archer versions. Mm-hmm. These are going to be very interesting to play, because in Kings of War, what you're generally seeing is your cavalry, your infantry, and your archers are all pretty mixed up, right?
Yes.
Centaurs are going to be sort of, you know, cavalry, frontline infantry, maybe? You know, and actually having cavalry archers is really going to be fun.
Yeah.
You know, fast-moving ranged attacks in Kings of War is really going to screw up some people's battle plans.
Where is Kings of War in this Forces of Nature thing?
Oh, they're neutral.
No, I meant, where are they in the releases? I mean, if this is appealing to me, are there other forces out, other miniatures
they
releases and stuff out for this faction? Or
the Forces of Nature are just around the corner, I think. I think they're coming out within the next couple of weeks. They should be up for pre-order.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But they've already shown off some stuff already. Unfortunately, we don't have the pictures here, but they have shown off some like tree folk and things like that. Mm-hmm. And I'm assuming we're going to get lots more in that sort of vein. We'll probably see druids and all that sort of thing coming up as well. But yeah, the centaurs are going to be a good counterpoint to the probably slow and quite ponderous tree men. So then you have these fast elements to the army as well.
Yeah,
really interesting to see how it all comes together.
Yeah, but it's also the fact that the forces of nature are neutral, so they can actually team up with the bad guys of the universe as well as the good guys. So it'll be interesting. Some people might actually do dark and twisted nightmare forest type armies mixed in with
abyssal
wars.
That'd be really awesome. Yeah,
you know, that could be really cool. If you're into your conversions, there's a project right there.
Is it? I guess nature don't care for gold.
No,
they just care for the
nature
existence
just
of nature.
Is, you know, it just is. So it'll fight for good or evil. Of course, this is if I remember correctly.
It's looking cool. I remember seeing the artwork a few months back. The nature stuff. I think it's even in the intro for the Kings of War miniseries. Mm-hmm. There's these trees and stuff, and it's cool to see this faction becoming a reality. It's really cool.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, the two newest factions for Kings of War are the Abyssals and the Forces of Nature, which was the last Kickstarter that Mantic did.
Mm-hmm.
So we've seen a lot of the Abyssal stuff coming out, so it's nice to see that Mantic's getting to move on to the Forces of Nature. I'm actually really curious to see where they go next with Kings of War, because the game now has its legs, it's up, it's running, people are having a great time with it, there's tournaments all over the place. Check out your local clubs and stuff, because tons and tons of people play it. I mean, even last weekend, the guy's got a 2,000 point game on. Right, 2,000 point game, Kings of War, how long do you think it takes, Lloyd?
An hour and a half.
You've been near the money, just a little over an hour. They actually played it with the chess clock and gave each other 45 minutes apiece to play the game.
Yeah.
And you see by the end of the game having that chess clock, it was just like, ah, 1 minute. Well, why did you only move one thing? It's your turn. I don't have time. Just go. I don't want to run out of time.
I want to give this chess clock thing a go.
It really puts me under the gun.
I've seen people do it, but I've never done it myself, and I always fancy the idea of it.
It's just, it makes the game so high pressure toward the end, because at the start you think, oh, I've got 45 minutes. Let's move that here, this here, this here. Okay, your turn. Yeah, I took 5 minutes.
Yeah, exactly. 5 minutes of looking around. Ben, where do you stand on this? Have you tried the chess clocks?
No, I've tried basic Kings of War without any of the timed element to it, and quite enjoyed it. But it would be interesting to play it with the chess clock actually, and see what, because I do tend to sort of ponder on my turns a little bit too much. I think they call it analysis paralysis. Yeah, so maybe I overthink things. I might run out of time.
Yeah, I actually do find that quite frustrating whenever I'm actually facing off against someone. During someone else's turn, I'm looking at the battlefield. I'm making my plans, even as they're moving up. I'll see a unit move into position. I'll go, okay, that, and that can deal with it. Then whenever it comes to my turn, I move everything in one shot. Their turn comes. I've done all my stuff, and they're just there going,
Well, that's maybe because your turn's over so quickly, because you just do all your stuff.
I don't know. I also think it's experience, because I am getting faster at playing games these days. I do not hang around. No, it's just, I see it and it's just like,
it's because Justin doesn't actually want to play anybody. He just wants to win and leave. It's like...
Yeah, you want to come in, take your tape measure, drop it, and walk out.
That's harsh. I like to play. I like to have fun.
Yeah. Anyway, so it's the Stalker and the Hunter Centaurs.
Yeah.
Yes, I see on the notes here that it's a dual metal kit.
Yep.
Cool. Looking forward to it. Right, moving us on. Ben, we're going to talk about a couple of things that have popped up on the site that you just love the look of.
Yeah, so I always like looking for stuff that's a bit quirky and a bit weird. And I also like looking at things that specifically is for hobbyists and collectors almost. Because I've started to look at it now as in I like painting single miniatures and working on them and things like that. So I picked out two. The first of these is by Mindwork Games, and it's their new Mushroom Shaman, who is this quirky, strange creature, possibly human, possibly not, who looks like he lives down underground and is like summoning up mushroom allies and things like that. All his armor and the clothing is made to look like mushrooms as well. And I just think the model is fantastic in 54 millimeter as well.
Ooh,
so it's
quite
pretty
big.
Yeah, so it's a pretty interesting project. The thing that I really liked about this is that, and something that Matteo Diomede, who's the painter of this, is he made it look like it's very natural. And he worked on the hat and things like that to give it a sheen and almost like a wet quality to it, which is fantastic in my mind. So
let's go back to looking at it again.
There you go.
Yeah. It does look cool, and I see the whole sheen and stuff. If we go to the back view, can we bring up the back view?
Yeah, you can see it. Yeah.
It literally does look very mushroomy. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised to see this later in the year as being like a suggestion
maybe.
For like best paint job.
Possibly.
You don't often see anything like this painted and in that fashion, but I'm also looking at it thinking, we just talked about the forces of nature.
Yeah.
I want this as a giant mushroom thing in my forces of nature.
So that would be so cool.
So hang on. Instead of having the tree giant, you're going to have the mushroom giant of doom. Yeah,
exactly. And I will mush you.
No. Oh, God.
No, that's bad.
No.
Don't worry, he's a fun guy, so it's okay.
What else have we got?
Going back to this model just for a second, it really reminded me there's a creature in Dungeons and Dragons called the Myconids, and they are a little bit like this. And I could see this being, if you wanted to try sort of using it as a model, using it as some kind of dungeon boss where it's like a Myconid king or a Myconid queen that's controlling all these little mushroom subjects, I think it'd be really cool. But yes, moving on. The next piece is by Figone. And this, they're a French company, and this is their fantastic project, which is called Moloch the Giant.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
this has been in production for a long time. It's a full resin kit, so you can imagine it's quite a weighty piece of, you know, stuff to work with. But this has been sort of in the works for months and months, and it was slowly getting worked on over last year. There was an Indiegogo campaign for it as well. It's finally now available, and I think this is absolutely insane.
Well, we're looking at the shield, and I'm loving the paint chipping and stuff that they've got on that
ancient battered look to it.
Whoever's been doing this paint job has been going to town.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. The painter for this is Jeremy Bonamont Thibault. Yeah. And he painted this up. So I'm trying to get all these French names right, and I think I'm getting them okay.
Can we go with the first image?
Yeah.
You know,
fantastic model.
I was just saying the other one might be in for best painted, and we've only just really got the awards out of the way for this year.
Yeah.
And now I'm looking at this, going, look at the tattoos and the shading and stuff. Now I know they're big miniatures and stuff, but yeah, that's just class.
Look at the detail. If we look at the bottom of this image on his axe, big, gigantic frost axe.
Yes. And it's basically just been tied to a tree trunk. Mm-hmm. So you can see that it's basically just this natural product that's just been like, oh, well, I'll take a tree and just stick a big, huge runic axe head on the end of it and it'll be fine.
That'll work.
really nice stuff there, Ben. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I can see what you mean by, you know, collector's pieces and stuff. Those are definitely, you know, any collector's going to look at those and go, oh.
Must have.
Yeah. Must have.
Must have, yeah.
Right, okay. Last on the list here of the news for this week is exciting stuff for me. Because it's Star Wars, and everything Star Wars is exciting for me. Star Wars Armada Wave 3 released, Justin.
I'm going to put it out there. My love for the Star Wars franchise is dimming. It's just, I've watched the latest one, I've then rewatched the latest one, and I can't like Kylo Ren.
How did you rewatch it?
Went
did
back
you go
to the
cinema again?
Yeah, of course I did.
I went to cinema twice as well.
Yeah, the second time through it was just like, of course, the second time through, it wasn't in 3D either, because the first time we watched it was in 3D, and that really dragged away from it, because I don't like 3D movies.
I preferred it in 2D as well.
Yeah, it was better in 2D, but I don't know, the storyline's just hooking me less and less.
Well, wait until the second one.
I know, there's more to find out, I'm not condemning it just yet.
Apparently the next one is like the bee's knees of darkness.
Bee's knees of darkness.
Let's see this stuff, for goodness sakes.
All right, well, bring Ben up on the screen, and I'll put it up here. Here we go. So, Star Wars Armada Wave 3 we're seeing, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So, this is some new ships for both sides, and they've done something a little bit different here. They've done the huge capital ships, and they've done the small squadrons. These are a set of ships that sort of fit in between both of them, and it's a flotilla ships. Mm-hmm. So, these are the ones like the Rebel transports. Well, they're one of the ones for the Rebels. And there's also the Imperial assault carriers as well.
We're just looking at the Rebel transports at the minute, Ben. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, what's the point of these? Do they buff other ships, or what's their role?
Okay, so the Rebel transport, from what we've seen in the preview so far, is they have like repair crews and things like that.
Yeah.
So they have the ability to fly around and sort of repair the bigger ships and keep the squadrons going and things like that. So they play a very support role.
Okay.
Because obviously they are just transports when you think about it in the wider scheme of things, but they've got that extra little benefit to being repair crews as well. So
cool. And then the Imperial stuff?
So the Imperial assault carriers, they basically do what the Empire do best, and that shoot stuff. But these guys boost all of that. So as Jana pointed out in the article, like they needed more firepower, but this helps aid squadrons and give them benefits and things like that. And they also have guns of their own. So it's basically more guns, more firepower, more destruction of rebel fleets, the scum and all that. So yeah.
That kind of does sum up the Empire, isn't it? Mm-hmm. The bigger the gun, the better. Because
well, it's the whole concept of more is more.
Well, in A New Hope, what did they do? They built a big gun.
Yeah, they built a big Death Star,
In Return of the Jedi, what did they do?
They rebuilt the big gun.
A big gun. In this new movie we've just watched, what did they build?
The bigger gun.
A big gun.
Oh, the bigger gun. Because you had the big gun, the redone big gun, now the bigger gun. And now they're going to have to build the bigger gun.
I hope to God it's the end of the build big gun stuff. I don't want to see any more big guns getting destroyed in Star Wars. All right, I want something different.
All right.
Right, let's move on, because we're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to be back to talk about some really interesting stuff.
Flames of War brings you the battles of World War II in epic 15mm scale. Go to the hub on beastofwar.com to find news, tactics, and tutorials about the game. From Viking halls to the cities of the future, terrain buffs will love our foreground hub. Watch gaming tables of all genres come to life at beastofwar.com.
Okay, man, do we have something exciting to talk about.
We have John here, so there's only one thing we can be talking about.
Oh, tanks!
Yes.
Literally, we're talking about tanks! Because some stuff just landed in the email,
mm-hmm.
you know, at the start of the day before we got into filming and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And we had to print it out and try it out. We got some prototype. Well, it's not even prototype. I think it's like preview stuff for tanks. Our Dropbox suddenly started filling up with a load of PDFs.
Tokens and all sorts of stuff.
Straight out of Gale Force Nine. Showing pretty much, I guess, what's going to be in the box. Justin, can you tell us what's actually in the tanks box?
Yeah, I have a list of what's going to come in the actual starter set. So,
And I'll just let flex
engage Ace Ventura voice.
This PDF that we received.
20-page rulebook, 3 plastic tanks, 1 Panther, 2 Sherman, 12 dice, 2 cardboard forests, 4 cardboard houses, 22 tank cards, 16 crew cards, 7 hero cards, 16 upgrade cards, 32 damage cards, and that's it.
Yes. So, we're a little confused as to which forests there are, because we've already got... Isn't it 2 forests?
Aye, 2 forests.
2 forests in the box,
But we've got, like, 2 sets of forests here.
Yeah, 2 styles.
And another 2.
I'm sure this is probably still work in progress.
So, but it was exciting stuff, and I thought, oh, we have to get this stuff printed out and give it a whirl and start to try and get to grips and get a feeling of this game.
And immediately handed it to me.
Of course. To you!
Yep. This has been fun.
Yeah,
because this is a game that has been written for me.
Okay.
Probably not on purpose.
But it works.
But I thank you. So this is basically a tank skirmish game.
Yes.
This is a... I would suggest, you know, as a beginner, it's a low model count skirmish. You get to play around with just a few tanks and kit them all out and stuff like that. And then you can obviously scale it up a bit. But it's 15 mil, or they are aiming it for 15 mil. And what I've been playing with at the minute is basically looking at the rules that we know and what we have in the materials and figuring out how this game works. And it's actually really good.
Yeah. I call German.
So it's... Tanks is a box set,
yeah.
as we've just talked about the contents of the box. It's essentially, it's Flames of War tanks with a different rule set that allows you to just play tanks.
Yeah.
Awesome!
But, well, it's a more micromanaged version of the tank games you would get, or the tank armies you would get in Flames of War.
You know what this reminds me of, John? You know the stories you always tell me about Michael Vittman rolling into a town on his own, facing off against a squad of 5 Shermans?
Yeah.
Are we going to get that with this game?
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
awesome. We are. That's what I wanted to know. That's what I wanted.
And the best thing is these tanks are going to feel like Vittman's commanding this one, or, you know, for example, Joe Atkins is the gunner in this Firefly. Mm. It will feel like that.
Nice.
Right, so we've got some stuff laid out on the... the table here.
Yeah.
So this is like all basically just cut out of those PDFs that we showed.
Yeah.
We've got cards and we've got a couple of proxy tanks.
Yeah.
This is a cunningly disguised Panther.
Yes. So that's a proxy.
Yeah.
Are these the actual
tanks?
These
are the actual tanks, yeah.
And if this is coming out of the Flames of War range, that's pretty much
exactly like,
if I go in closer, they're pretty much going to be that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That tank.
Mm-hmm. That's fine.
And this tank.
Yeah. Maybe.
Sherman and Firefly.
Maybe, but not that tank. We're just proxying with that.
Yes.
Yeah. But there's nothing to say that you might not eventually get that tank.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So you've had some time now playing with it, John.
Mm-hmm.
Can you show us some of the basics? I don't want you to do a full demo game or anything.
Okay.
I just want you to give us a flavor of, you know,
on a turn?
How does it work?
Right. Simply, movement is all based on these little arrows.
Yes.
And these little arrows are approximately 6 inches.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
So... to move, let's say, for example, I want to move, we'll move the Firefly over here.
Okay. Yes.
So the direction of travel is noted by the arrow.
Okay.
So I can turn it around a little bit and say, right, this Firefly is going to come around the corner.
Okay.
You then take this tank and you move it along the line to the tracks meet the front of the arrow.
Okay.
That's the distance that can move at a normal pace.
Right.
Some tanks can say they can move double that if they want, if you want to speed things up.
Mm-hmm.
Makes it worse for shooting and so on.
Right. Quick question. Does it have to sit square against it like that?
Yes.
Okay.
The tank, if you can bring up the camera again there, Lloyd, the tank has to finish its move square to the arrow. So it can sit like that or it can sit like that, so long as it is actually square to it, or it can...
The arrow kind of represents a square set.
Yeah.
Aye.
That head on the arrow and then the tail.
Yeah. Yeah, but you seem to be just moving up to the head.
Yes.
Well, you can move anywhere along the arrow,
yes.
I believe.
But you have to stop. You can't pass
the
head of the arrow. You have to actually stop you know, where that is there at the minute.
Okay.
But if you want to move further, you can move further and just move again. But what happens is your shooting becomes less accurate. Or you get... I don't know if you get easier to be shot at, but certainly your shooting becomes less accurate because
you become harder to hit the faster you move. It would make more sense to me.
It's more like you're always shooting, you're always rolling the same amount of dice for shooting.
Yeah.
But whether you've moved changes things, and whether they've moved possibly changes things.
Okay. Okay.
It's more, there's more of a penalty to you moving and shooting than it is for your opponent to try and drive off.
Okay.
Okay.
When does my Panther activate?
Well, this is the interesting part. This is down to the initiative phase, or the initiative side of it.
So this tank here we're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Am I okay to demonstrate the cards a little bit?
Let me just go to a wider shot. There you go.
Okay, so on the card, and
can't really see it, but
we can't really see it.
Describe.
But there's large numbers here, large colorful numbers. The blue one is the initiative. So for movement, mm-hmm. the tanks with the lowest initiative go first.
Okay.
And that includes both players.
Okay.
So if, say for example, my Panther was initiative 5 and your Sherman was initiative 4, mm-hmm. your Sherman will move and my tank will move, and then if you have something that's lower than, or higher, then it'll move.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's sort of, you're both doing the same thing at the same time.
So you're running up the initiative steps to say, okay, you move, you move, you move, you move. Do you have to do all your movement at the same time?
Yes, everybody moves, everybody shoots, and then there's a third phase called the command phase.
Okay.
Okay.
And that's where other things happen, and I can get
okay.
to that in a minute.
I'm just going to throw it out there because some people will go, it sounds a bit like X-Wing. And it does sound a bit like X-Wing. And I'd be really proud if I come up with a game and people said, that sounds like X-Wing, because X-Wing's a really fun game to play.
All right. Well, let's play it this turn, John. I'll take control of the Panther. I'm not going to move.
Right. So you're staying stationary then?
Yes.
Okay. The Firefly has moved.
Uh-huh.
He's on the lower initiative, so he would have moved first anyway.
Yep.
You're going to not move.
I'm going to sit still and take a good aimed shot at you.
Okay, so you're wanting to fire.
Uh-huh.
So
because you moved, do you get one of these?
Yes, I do. This is a movement token.
Yeah.
Which denotes how many arrows you've moved.
Yeah, okay. so you've gone one.
I've moved one, so right. I'll put that there.
And I've gone none, so
you've gone none. That's fine.
Uh-huh.
So, on the cards then, we're going to move on to shooting. Now, shooting works with the initiative in reverse.
Okay.
So highest initiative goes first for shooting.
Yeah, I get to shoot.
Okay, so you were going to go first.
Okay.
On your card, you have the red stat. Now, the red stat is attacks. So the attacks for the Panther are 5, so you roll 5 dice.
Okay.
Okay. So for the Panther to attack our Firefly, he has 5 dice.
Okay.
He's remained stationary.
Uh-huh.
This tank here we're talking about.
Yeah. This one has remained stationary on his card. He also has add-ons to the tank.
Right. Yes. That's what these cards here represent.
These extra cards around the main tank card are important.
Because crew and upgrades,
Crew, upgrades, and other things you can burn when you need to.
This brings us to that point that you made of liking the game in so much as you're sort of micromanaging a tank.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you've got these options. Unlike other games, a higher abstraction in the level, like Flames of War, or whatever, your tank moves and shoots.
Yep.
Here you've got upgrades and specific things for the tanks. And,
I kind of like to just have a little dashboard
and
for
stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Very cool. Right, so...
Just before we jump into it, but I also believe you can put heroes and stuff in the tanks.
I was about to bring that up. I'm reading one of them here. It's Michael Vittman.
Yes, we have Michael Vittman. And there are several other heroes. As we've said in the box contents, there are 7 cards.
Yeah.
Those heroes aren't necessarily tank commanders. You have tank commanders, obviously Wittmann was a commander, but on the German hero card you can also have Bobby Voll, who was Wittmann's gunner.
Ah, see.
On the British side you can have, I believe it's Radley Walters as a tank commander, but you can also have Joe Ekins as your gunner, who was a guy that engaged Michael Wittmann way back in the day.
Yeah, okay. I'll assume I have to pay extra points for those, yeah?
Yes, you're paying the points that are listed on the cards, and all the cards have the points values there for them.
All right, well, reading Michael Vittman, I'm getting +1 shot.
Yep, you get... Vittman will give you, on this card says, Vittman will give you +2 initiative, which puts your Panther up to 9 initiative.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So for shooting, he is pretty much always going first.
Oh, yeah! Boom!
So he's always shooting first, essentially, so far. He also gets +1 attack.
Yeah.
So he will boost this Panther up to 6 attack dice.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe we have anything else that will matter.
I have a tungsten shot, but I'm not going to use it.
No, because it burns. You discard that card.
Mm-hmm.
And that's another one of those upgrades that once you've used it, you get rid of it. It goes to your discard pile.
Okay, so I roll. What do I need to hit?
You need 4, 5, or 6 to hit. And you roll
6.
All right.
You
roll a 6. A 6 is fun because a 6 is a critical hit.
Yeah. Okay.
The critical hit then falls to this little deck of cards, which is your damage.
Okay.
So You want to? In fact, because I'm the guy you're taking the hit.
You flip it.
I'll flip it. So
what have I done to you?
Bailed out. The tank doesn't take any damage.
Okay.
Which it states there, but my crew bail out.
Okay.
So the shots went in, mm-hmm. scared the living daylights out of everyone. It's a panther, and they bailed out.
Yeah.
But another thing on the card, it says repairable.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what will happen in the command phase after we've both done our shooting.
Okay. So you still get to shoot at me, even though I bailed you out?
Well, yes.
Okay.
I think. We haven't got that far yet.
Let's say you do.
Yes, okay. So I'll try and shoot back with the Firefly now.
Okay. Now, did you get any defensive rolls for that?
Oh, yes. Actually, I do have defensive rolls. Quite. Thank you for that. So the Firefly has a defense of 1.
Uh-huh. Okay.
He's in the open, but he's moved.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
so let's say he's here.
So the Sherman Firefly has moved 1. Mm. Because he's moved, he's more difficult to hit. This is where movement actually comes in quite handy. So the Sherman has a defense of 1 standard.
Okay.
But because he's moved, he gets a second.
Right. I didn't move.
No, you didn't.
Does that take 1 away?
No.
No?
You roll normally.
Ah, okay.
Because you sat stationary and went, eh. And because I've moved, my defense is higher.
Okay.
All right, so there you go. You do get extra defense from moving your tank around rather than sitting as a sitting duck. So it kind of works in both ways. You didn't move, so you're shooting good.
Mm.
But he did move, so he's dodging your bullets or your shells.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's just a bit tougher to hit because he's on the move.
Okay.
So I have to roll a 4, 5, or 6.
Uh-huh.
So I'll do that.
6.
I roll a 6. You hit me once with a critical.
Yeah.
I can get rid of that critical.
Okay.
That did not happen, so...
Okay. So what if you had rolled a 4 or 5?
If I'd rolled a 4 or 5, I could still negate that.
Ah, but I think if... I had a glance at this earlier. If it's a 4 or a 5,
mm-hmm.
I get to choose. If it's a
yes.
6, you get to choose.
Yes.
That's what I'm driving at here.
But in this case, because you only hit me once, there's only 1 dice to get rid of.
Yeah, but you got the 6 anyway.
Exactly, yes. So... Now I can shoot.
Yep.
Yes.
So what's your rate of fire then?
Right. So my fire is the same as the Panther because I'm a Firefly. I have a big anti-tank gun.
Which card are you working off here, John?
Off this one up here. So
let's see if we can get that card.
All right.
I'll bring this in. So here we go. So the Firefly has an attack of 5.
Aye, okay.
Now, that's not all he has. He also has a hero with him.
Okay.
So this is Radley Walters.
Mm-hmm.
This is another British tank commander. When this tank shoots, its target has -1 defense.
It's okay, I've still got 6 defense.
No, you have 2 defense, which I bring down to 1.
Okay.
And you are not going... Well, you might potentially be in cover. No, you're not in cover. We can explain that in a minute as well. So, I have 5 dice.
Mm-hmm.
Again, same as you, 4, 5, or 6.
Okay.
Oh, 5 and 2 6.
2 5s, 2 6s.
Okay.
Ooh.
No, this is fun. Do you want to roll your defense of 1?
Okay.
You can roll your defense of 1.
Go on, Justin. You can do it.
6.
Right. So
I'll
you
get
can...
rid of a critical.
Right. So you can drop 1 critical. So.
All right.
I'm
actually going to quickly shuffle this.
Okay. He's going to shuffle it.
Wait. Did you load the deck?
No.
He looked at the deck.
I looked at the deck. Right. So.
I draw 1 of these then
yep.
for 1 of my damages.
Let's see what you got.
Bailed out.
So you got bailed out.
Yeah.
Let's do something different.
Let's do a different card, yeah.
Let's pick something that is rather harsh, shall we?
Okay.
Just for the sake of the video, so.
You're right, friendly game, John. Thanks.
I just want to see how cruel I can be to him, all right? So no, no, maybe, no.
Pick over my corpse, why don't you?
Yeah, why not?
He's sitting there going, nasty, but not nasty enough.
Not nasty enough. Okay, so he has got 2 damage received and injured crew.
Ooh, nasty!
Thanks. Target player discards 1 crew card from his tank.
Oh, yeah.
You only have 1 crew card, which is Michael Wittman.
Bye, Michael.
That didn't happen in history.
Michael is dead.
That's not historical.
I've killed Wittman with a Firefly. I think that is good enough. There are plenty of people who will argue that
otherwise. So on top of that... I assume it's down to damage tokens then, which are these little things, yeah?
Mm-hmm. Yep, so we have damage tokens, so you can put 1...
2, 3.
Yep.
So we have 1 with a 3, I'll put that on my tank.
Yep.
Thankfully, also, I have 6 damage.
By the looks of it, you also have sort of a more traditional sort of damage counter on the tank card.
Yeah.
So if you have the cards laminated or whatever, you can
mark the little dots there.
Mark the dots out.
So Justin, are you half dead or half alive?
I am Schrodinger's tank.
It doesn't know if it's in the box or out the box or whatever. Yeah. So
I'm dumbfounded. Justin brought science into this, yo.
No. You've never heard of Schrodinger's cat.
Yeah, science and yo.
Until you look inside the box, you don't know if that cat's dead or alive.
Science.
You don't know
and
if my tank's dead or alive.
So if that panther was in the house, is that then we just don't know if it's dead or not?
Yeah, Schrodinger's tank in that house. That'll do.
Okay. Yeah. Fine.
Okay. Tangent. Move on.
Okay, so that's on to the command step then, yeah?
Yeah, so on the command phase, once we've both shot, command phase is basically sort of housekeeping. So my movement counter will go away.
Yeah, you need to roll for your build out then.
I need to roll for my build out, which is one dice, four, five, or six. Mm-hmm. So I'll roll that.
Five. That's fine.
That crew gets back in.
Okay.
And then we start over again.
Okay.
So
that's a game turn. That's how quick it is?
That's essentially the turn, yeah. Obviously, right. The more tanks you add, the slower that's going to become. But
it's not slow. We sat and talked it out.
Yeah.
And that was just tank to tank.
If you play that normally, once you know the system, you'll be nipping through it, and you'll be able to have big tank battles, which is what you can't really do in Flames of War.
You can, but it can be a little bit...
It can take a long time.
Yeah. Important question. Mm. Something we talked about ages ago, Lloyd. Does it all have to be from the same faction on your side? Does it have to be all... Damn.
Which is good, because I don't... As much as we've talked about doing World of Tanks on the tabletop, I don't want this to be World of Tanks.
Do you remember your talk about spotting mechanics?
Yes. Mm.
That kind of works in this, but it's different. So opponents either side of the table have everything set out. Mm-hmm. Your crew cards, your upgrade cards, your ammunition, stuff like that, are face down.
Well, hang on. We had it set up like this,
We had it set up like this for simplicity, but at the start of a game,
all
of those are face down. On the back of the cards is
This is cool.
On the back of the cards is the points cost of those cards. Right. So your opponent can look at it and go, that's a big upgrade.
That's 11 points. Is that Vitman?
That's 11 points.
That
could be a good commander or something like
that. This is really cool being able to look over and go, he spent a lot of points on that. How has he spent those points?
All right, now, quick question. Say it was Vitman in here and I wanted to get the extra shot from him.
Yes.
Would I then have to flip him and reveal him?
Yes. Once his ability kicks in, or once you use an upgrade, the card flips over.
Yeah.
Oop. So you then become aware of what that tank has.
Okay. Right. So I can't make him flip the stuff over.
If I want to use it, I have to reveal it.
And that's it for the game, because obviously I've seen it then. I think it doesn't go...
Yeah. Unless you have commanders that say, boost your defense. And if you go to take a defensive role and you want to use that, that card has to flip over. And it's like, that's that guy in that tank.
That's how he's doing that, so that you're not having people calling random stuff through a game.
That's class. That's even better than what I'd thought about of discovering tank tokens and stuff.
Yep.
Because this means, as the game goes on, I don't discover straight away that tank is this. Mm-hmm. I already know what tank it is, because I can see it on the field. Mm-hmm. But what it means is I'm not going to discover all your upgrades all in one go.
Yeah,
but
there'll still be mystery about your tank to be revealed.
Say this was a Stug. You could be rolling your Firefly up to my Stug and actually going, yeah, it's just a Stug, my Firefly can kill that.
Yeah.
But wait a minute, there's Vitman in the Stug. Boom.
Yeah, so it boosts things. That's another interesting point, actually. They've changed it's a new game. The mechanics for a turretless tank are different.
Yes. Okay.
Because I believe in Flames of War, it's a 45-degree arc front.
Okay. So there's a turretless tank. How does it work?
Okay, on a turretless tank, he can only see what is immediately in front of him at all times. He cannot see to the left or right
just
at all.
The width of his mini?
Width of the vehicle in a straight line.
Yes. Okay.
That's what he can shoot.
Okay, so you have to be a little bit more clever with your positioning then.
Yeah, during your move step, it's quite important to get the tank round into position.
Yeah.
Probably, I would say, I would take Stugs against something that has already activated.
Yeah, here it is.
Or already moved.
Yeah, I was just looking for it there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's the diagram.
Let's see if we can get a bit closer.
Right there.
So that's the diagram that we see. And
it's just a straight line.
Yep.
The Stug can
only see
it
in a straight line. Yep.
Okay. Cool.
I'm looking forward to getting a few games of this in, John.
I am as well.
So I'll tell you what.
But the rule book as we have it here,
on
what page, because I've printed it in two bits, what does it go up to?
Nine.
It goes up to about 20.
Yeah, it goes up to about 20, and some of those are... background sort of pages and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really a case of you can pick
And there's submissions in here too.
You get the box, pick it up and play in within like an hour or so.
Yeah.
Well, John, with us having this in here, I'm actually going to grab myself a set of something German.
Okay.
And we'll see what happens. I'll get a game against you, okay?
Okay.
I'm liking it a lot because it's another entry point. It's the sort of thing I look at it in Flames of War and think, oh, I have to build a whole army before I can get playing.
Yeah, now I can look at it and go, I'm going to build five tanks.
Yeah, I can pick this up. If I picked it up for my mate and he got the two tanks and I got the one tank,
yeah,
I'm only dealing with one tank and I'm playing.
I don't know. I think this is good for guys that already play things like Flames of War because they can instantly pick up this rule set and go, massive battles.
Yeah.
No, I think this is excellent for people who've never dipped their fingers into Flames of War.
I'm saying both.
Well, yes, of course it's good for both, but I'm looking at it going...
You want to play?
I do want to play.
You want to play?
I've always been a little hesitant about making a massive Flames of War army because it's a big investment in it. Mm-hmm. I don't have a lot of time. But this I mentioned the X-Wing thing. This tickles me like X-Wing. So much as I'm looking at it going, I don't need a lot of time. I can jump into this game. Mm. You know, we could walk out there now and I could be playing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In a very short time.
Very much a pick up and play.
I'm not walking out and going, John going, well, you need to go buy this or paint that or build this.
Go research this division in this year, in this theater.
Yeah.
We walk out there and John goes, come on over and let's play.
Yeah.
I love it.
I like the idea. I really like the idea.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right, Lloyd.
Tanks, that was.
Yeah. Now, hang on, Lloyd. I'm about to kick you out of the studio.
Yeah.
Because we have Alessio coming in for a very big announcement. I'm going to keep John for this one because he's really going to go nuts for it. So, guys, we're going to move on here. We'll tell you about some hubs and we'll be back in a second.
In a world controlled by massive corporations, a steady aim and split-second decisions are needed for your Megacon to complete its goals. Begin your missions at the Mercs Hub on beastofwar.com. Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastofwar.com.
And okay, we are joined by Alessio. John, you've jumped in on this one.
I have jumped in on this one.
You couldn't resist this one.
I couldn't resist this one. And a lot of people are going to be thinking, are we going to talk about tanks? No, we're not.
Not quite.
Not quite. This is a little different.
Will I press the button and show the world, Alessio?
Yeah, that's gone. Let's unleash.
Unleash hell?
Unleash hell.
Ta-da! Guys, if you didn't know before, you now know. River Horse is doing a My Little Pony role-playing game.
That's right. Tales of Equestria with the intentional spelling mistake, of course, which is in keeping with the IP, where you know everything is spelled wrong in terms of like every pony knows that.
Yeah. Well, everyone else is looking at the ponies here. Do you want to know what I'm seeing on this? In the bottom right corner. The two logos sitting side by side, Hasbro and River Horse together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you notice that our logo actually got a little bit pink in this. Is because it's a stark black and white, and it actually didn't quite match. So we went for a different color palette there. Mm-hmm.
But this is one hell of a big step for you, Alessio.
It's very exciting. You know, it is very, very, very exciting.
No, it's not just the IP; it's the doors this is going to open for you.
Yeah. So my first question is, why My Little Pony?
Well, I have a seven-year-old daughter, and of course I got infected by this, as many dads will go, right. First I've heard of My Little Pony, and I thought back to the 80s when I was young, and I remember this old combing hair thing, etc., and I wasn't particularly interested. Then I happened to see a little bit of a show, the TV series, or series one, I think, my daughter was watching, and I was like, that's a Hydra.
Yeah.
It's like a manticores, castle, spells, fantasy. I started, you know, little by little to watch bits and bobs and go magic duels, wizardry, powerful creatures, and chaos and force. So it was like high fantasy.
Yeah.
Yeah. And once you get into the story, because of the setting, I was like, wow, this is not at all what I remember. It's actually quite a very cool TV series. I looked at it, and actually, the characters are amazingly well written. Mm-hmm. There's music in it. I like musicals in general. Yeah, yeah. So I love the music. I love that. You get to love the characters. There's so much fun, humor. And I suppose I'm biased because I love watching my daughter. So, you know, there's an emotional level for me there. They were sharing this together, etc. But, you know, from the first reaction of, oh, wow, fantasy, I started to think as a gamer.
It's the moment of getting past going, it's My Little Pony.
Yeah, well, if you think of the old Mount the Ponies, not something that I felt any attraction for as an IP. But this new series, I've watched all of it now several times with my daughter, for research and development, of course.
For science.
For science. But, yeah, I really enjoy it.
The thing is that I've researched, as some of the people in the community know and some of the people in the office know, I have researched this. And the original My Little Pony did have that high fantasy feel to it, but it suffered from 80s animation and storytelling. It just wasn't as punchy as what the current stuff is.
Ah, but the whole target audience has always been little girls. Does this new series step away from that?
Oh, wow. Well, you're asking me a big question there. Yes, it does, in a way.
Okay.
But I would say that's purely down to the original writer of the current series, which was Lauren Faust. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people will know Lauren Faust from writing the Powerpuff Girls and working on a lot of those Cartoon Network shows that we were all quite fond of when we were a bit younger.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she threw her hand to this IP and reinvented it in a way. So she went back to that high fantasy style, but wanted better storytelling behind it. Mm-hmm. But she more wanted a show that people like yourself, Alessia, could sit down with your daughter and you could watch it, and you would get something out of it, and your daughter would get something out of it.
Yes, it's that thing, and it's at different levels, like in many modern animation, where the grown-up watches the thing and gets some jokes and gets some references that the young one doesn't actually get at all. Yep. So you always get different things from it, but both enjoy it.
Yeah.
Well, it's... All right, Alessio, you're doing a role-playing game.
Yes.
I assume this is you going, you know what, I want to create a game for my daughter. How are you working this out? Because you now understand the world after your research.
Yes.
For science.
Yes.
Yeah. How does this game work?
Well, there's two things. One is obviously the IP and the love for that, but also as a designer, I was wanted, since I was a young teenager, I was thought, one day I'll write a role play system, which obviously is something that, again, I'm pressing that button as well, kind of feeling one bit that I haven't done, which is the role play. I played zillions of role playing games, but actually never written one. So this is my first foray into that. In that, and you know, it's kind of a dream come true from a geek point of view. It's like, done that as well. Tick. Absolutely. So it's been great fun to develop it. I mean, I have here some early mock-ups of character sheets because these are PCs.
Okay, so
pony characters,
yeah,
of course, not player characters.
All right, so this is what we're getting for your player sheet.
Well, that is your player sheet if you want to play as a Pegasus.
Okay.
Of course, there's a little silhouette of a Pegasus for you to color in. I mean, to finish up, and then there's a unicorn silhouette, and there's the character sheet with the Earth pony silhouette, and there's also, if you're more artistically, you know, gifted, then you have an empty one where actually you can draw from scratch. All of them, of course, have the little cutie mark thing here, which you can fill in all of them. So character creation is one of the three main pony kinds, and nobody can start as an alicorn. No. We thought that was, it was clearly over the top.
Okay, for anyone who doesn't know what an alicorn is,
doesn't anybody know
what
every pony knows what an alicorn is, right?
What is an alicorn?
The alicorns are the princesses in the world. So you have Celestia, who's princess of the sun, and you have Luna, princess of the moon. Mm. You also have a couple others, but a lot of people don't like them. Twilight Sparkle became one.
Okay.
Through a lot of controversy.
Okay.
But yes, they are basically the most powerful in this universe.
Okay.
The alicorns are the ruling class, essentially. They are the people in charge.
And when I saw the term alicorn, I don't know if it was being created for this IP, but that's the first time I came across the term alicorn, which, you know, since I, you know, I've done classic studios, when I saw that, I went, alicorn, wing, in Latin, winged horn. And I went, wow, yes. Because, you know, in the past, when you have the concept of a Pegasus, which has a horn, or a unicorn with wings, whichever way around, always been defined with these terms. There's never been a proper nice... Well, I never came across it. It may have already existed, of course. I don't know everything, of course. But for me, this was the first time to come across the word, and I was like, beautiful. I really liked it. You know,
really
winged
well.
Horn.
Okay, unicorn. Awesome.
And so, yeah, they are the powerful rulers of Equestria. Yeah. So,
so
you can all start as one of those.
Okay, so you have your three types of pony. You have your Earth pony, unicorn, and Pegasi.
Mm-hmm.
How do these break down into character classes then?
Well, these are the three classes, effectively. So you can start with one of the three. what differentiates every pony is that they all every pony is that you have a talent, which is reflected in your kitty mark, will be reflecting your name, your colors, etc. So the talent that you have, which could be many, there's zillions of them, mm-hmm. From making pie to, I don't know, to being good at the fashion design, to casting powerful fire-based spells. You know, there's all sorts of things here. Yeah.
Okay.
And you can basically choose that mm-hmm. Within your class, which is one of the three kinds. Mm-hmm. And then you develop your character going through adventures in a quest. It's just a role-play game. A character has a number of stats, very few. I kept it very simple because intentionally I want this to be an introductory role-play game. Where ideally for me, this is a grown-up, mm-hmm. a dad, mom, big sister, big brother, babysitter, somebody, grandma, whatever, with a bunch of kids. Most of them girls, perhaps, because they're more into the kind of IP, but actually boys are being buying into this too. So, a bunch of kids, and you play together, and you share this together. You're the grown-up, you're telling the story, and the kids are the characters in the play. I'm sure that they will not just be limited to kids. I mean, I can see me and some other my friends playing this. We could play this, we could all play this for fun. But ideally, I really think if this brings families together, brings kids and their friends together to play, because obviously the main theme is friendship. Friendship is key in all of this.
Okay.
I think that one of the big things about this series is the message is very, very nice. It's very positive, mm-hmm. it's very cheerful, it's all about friendship. So if that helps people, kids, playing together, staying together, role-playing, as opposed to, like being stuck into iPads and stuff all the time. For me, that's amazing. It's success.
Yeah. Okay. All right, well, let's create a character for John. off the bat, let's create a character for John.
Would you like to be an Earth Pony, a Pegasus, or a Unicorn? I'll tell you in-game rules-wise. Obviously, if you start as a Pegasus, mm-hmm. you get the fly talent on top of the normal talent, so you have effectively the ability to fly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. At the basic level, this is all ranked in dice, so it's all the river or system where every dice, which is used across most of our games, mm-hmm. where every die is color-coded, so the D4 is red, the D6 is green, and so on. So I always refer to them as the green dice, the red dice, the yellow dice, again, for simplicity, mm-hmm. and color. So they're colorful, they're simple. So unicorns have a green dice for the fly ability, D6, so you're kind of a basic flyer, a Fluttershy level kind of thing, not very good. And then you have so that's for Pegasus.
Yep.
Unicorns have the telekinesis D6, so telekinesis green level, mm-hmm. which means they can move stuff around using magic. So you see the horn lights up, uh-huh. and the object lights up, and they just move it around. Yeah, okay. So it can do some sound manipulation. But again, the green level D6 is not high level, of course. Mm-hmm. If you're, I don't know, Twilight Spark will be on D12s, D20s, moving entire hordes of ponies and herself and stuff. Right. So her level of telekinesis is very high.
In case you're wondering out there, and Twilight Sparkle is the purple one in the middle.
Yes, indeed.
Just because I do expect some people to be sitting watching this going, what are they talking about?
And me and Alessia are having a whale of a time. Everyone out there is just confused.
What?
Okay.
Earth ponies don't have any extra talent, but what they do have is they have an extra bonus on their body ability. But basically, one of the stats, you have body and mind, they're the two main stats, and then there's charm. But body and mind, you start with a D4 in one and a D6 in another. Earth ponies, whatever they decide to put there, they upgrade the dice to the next best dice, so they actually are stronger.
Yeah.
Which also in turn means they have more stamina points, which mm-hmm. are effectively the wounds. Well, nobody gets really hurt here, but you can get knocked out, depressed, taken prisoner. So you have more stamina. More mm-hmm. stamina and a stronger body, so you have better physical abilities, physical things. And so that's what the Earth Pony is about. Mm-hmm. Also, there are some talents which are accessible because you can have more talents and develop future talents, of course, mm-hmm. as well as your kitty mark talent. Mm-hmm. And some of them are restricted to some of the kinds. Mm. So, which one would you like to be?
What do you think?
You're making me.
I'm going to make.
Yeah. Why don't you both
choose?
Pick a character?
I'm going to make you choose what my character should be.
No, I'll pick one for myself.
You pick a character.
All right, fine. Earth Pony.
I'll take a Pegasi, just for a giggle.
Okay, I'll be the unicorn then, fine.
Okay.
You're the smart one, right? He's thinner than me. And
yes, in a way, you could say...
And you're the tough, strong one.
In fact, you could say...
I wouldn't say strong, but...
Fighter, wizard, rogue, effectively, really.
That actually makes sense.
Speaking of the stereotypes, you know, the wizard.
Okay.
The rogue. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the fighter.
I'm all sneaky-like. Okay, so what's the next stage then?
Well, then you would decide, for example, you go for the sheet, you have the pony name, but that kind of happens at the end, because first you need to do the rest. Mm-hmm. So the name of the player, the type of pony, so obviously we'll write whatever we chose. Our level, we start on level one. Mm-hmm. There is an option to start as a level zero, so as a cutie mark crusader, where you don't have your cutie mark yet. but you know, normally you start on level one. You're a young pony who just got a cutie mark and is stepping into the world.
Right.
You would choose. You have a D4 and a D6, and you have to allocate them to your body and mind. So you can, as a unicorn, I will definitely put my D6 in mind and D4 in body.
Okay.
Basically, because I see that mind for me would be more important. Yeah.
Yeah. Casting spells.
Yes. Okay. All my my charm. Everybody's on a D6 to start with. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So where would you put your better dice? Mind or body?
I'm going to say body, just to be a little bit tougher.
Yeah, tougher, or you can go into the agile, because in a body it's not just about strength, it's about coordination, skill, etc. So, you know, you could be very, very agile, very good at flying.
Basically, for this role-playing game, we have three stats to worry about.
Yeah, and they're all rated as just a dice.
Okay, that's actually going to make this really quick and easy to play for the younger players out there. Mm-hmm. I really like that idea. What do you think, John?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously, because I'm an Earth Pony, everything's going to the body and not too concerned about charm or mind, to be honest.
Right, Simon, you're the clever one leading the two idiots around.
Well, you're
a swift idiot, at least.
Swift idiot and a strong idiot, yes.
Yeah.
The swift one and the strong
swift
one.
And the strong one.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So you would get D4 in body and a D6 in... a D4 in mind and a D6 in body.
Yeah.
And then because you're an Earth Pony, that will be upgraded to a D8. So you go D4, D8, which is the extreme Earth Pony, you know, big and strong, big Macintosh, basically.
Yeah.
if you had the other way around, then you both would be on D6, which is a nice balanced Earth Pony. I don't know, Pinkie Pie. Kind of things. Well, did I say that Pinkie Pie is balanced? That's probably a bad example. I mean Applejack.
Once more, if you're wondering, Applejack's the orange one. Pinkie Pie is obviously the pink one.
Correct.
Just for those out there who are just going, what? Why?
She is literally the fourth wall breaker of the universe.
Yeah, she's technically the child-friendly Deadpool of the universe.
Yes, yes. Doesn't quite get so. Deadpool, but yes, yes.
She talks to the audience a lot more than she talks to anyone else. And herself.
Yeah. Indeed.
Okay, so we've done that. I'll assume there'll be talents and weakness lists coming
talents,
for it.
You basically pick the first talent, which is your CM, your cutie mark talent. Okay. That's what defines you, really. It probably influences your name, your colors, and everything, is that. So, for example, I often start with my unicorn. The name of the unicorn is Firebrand.
Right.
And my cutie mark is actually a little, either firework or just flame.
Okay.
And my talent is about making beautiful fireworks. I can make amazing good fireworks. I'm really good with fire magic, so to speak.
You're a pyromancer.
Pretty much, yes. Oh, the only peaceful applications, of course.
Of course.
We don't hurt anybody with fire.
Mm-hmm. But I'll call mine Silver Shadow.
Well, all right. So, and your cutie mark talent would be? What's your talent? What are you good at?
Starting from shadow to shadow without being seen.
Being stealthy, Stealth. Cool, stealth,
yes. So, sneaky. I haven't figured a name for mine yet.
You don't have to do it now. It's a bit sad. But yeah, you can think of what the theme of your character is going to be, whether you want to be about speed, about strength, about skill, what kind of... So, you know, and you create your character. Then you also pick weaknesses.
Okay.
Where basically, to make the character more interesting, because again, the characters are very well written, they all have, you can all immediately identify, and it's played on, you know, with cutie marks, when they lose the cutie marks, they also have weaknesses in the sense, I don't know, rarity is a bit greedy sometimes, you know, when it goes, ooh, shiny! Gems. So you just pick something that makes your character a bit more interesting. Like, I remember my daughter put there, fear of zombies. I was like, okay!
But it's well seen, she knows her dad.
Yes, I just go, they're not going to be many zombies, to be honest, but yeah, okay, right, yeah. Fear of zombies
it is. The fact that she knows you and just goes, I know you, you may put zombies in this, this will work.
It's just with zombies.
There would be dragons, then.
There would be dragons, and also, you know, like chimeras.
Well, so it's very thematic whenever you're picking talents and weaknesses and stuff. So I'm guessing as you're playing through, the parent or whoever's running it can really just, you know, okay, you're doing this, describe it out to me. Okay, I'm going to say you'll need this dice for this, this attribute for this.
Yeah, when you meet, basically there's challenges and what's the term we decided to use? One, challenges is when you test against somebody else that is opposing you. So for example, when we are arm wrestling, mm-hmm. Or oof wrestling, we would have your body value against my body value. So we just roll our dice. I have a green dice, you have a red dice. We roll and the highest wins. So that's simple in a challenge. When you're actually facing something fixed, like you know you're trying to break down a door, you know, the person who's running the game master will go, okay, that door is a flimsy plywood one. The difficulty level of this is 2, 3, yeah. whatever. And yeah. then you know if you have a big chunky dice, rolling a 3 or more, easy. If you have a d4, suddenly you're rolling a 3 or more, you go, eh, okay. So a weak pony will have trouble. And of course, if you want a giant oak bar reinforced door, then you go, yeah. right, the difficulty for this is 14. I go, ooh, I have a d6. It's not impossible.
Okay. Mm. Yeah,
it's not impossible. There are mechanisms to do it, there are alternative things you can do, but in general, you know, you just set the level, and a clever game master will obviously look at, you know, what the character can achieve, and maybe either give them a chance, or give them a...
Yeah.
It's just
not... Yeah,
okay.
So if
you have
you're
a
d6, using a...
5.
A magical character, you could look at that big, nasty oaken door and go, got a simple turnkey lock. Can I actually rotate that lock?
Yeah, or can I look through the hole? Oh, look, there's a set of keys, you know, there.
If I can see those keys, I can float them.
I can float them to the door from the other side.
Totally story driven.
Yeah, there's also the exploding hoof technique, which basically is if you roll if you roll the best result for your dice, you're allowed to roll the next higher dice, and you can use either result. So if I roll a 4 on a d4, I can then roll the d6 and have a chance. But I can choose whichever result I want. If I roll the 6 for the d6, then I can roll the d8. So go red, green, yellow, you upgrade.
So if you got insanely lucky, you could get right the way up to d20.
You can, in theory, always reach 20, but the chances of that, obviously, the higher, the curve is very steep, the higher the chances of rolling again are very, very,
it's
very
nice
low.
To have that mechanic in there, and it's a very clever mechanic.
I already have the scenario in my head, and it's your unicorn just detonating the door off its hinges and everyone else looking at her and just going, what? It's like, I like fireworks.
It reminds me of an old D&D wizard I used to play with. Not my character, but a friend's character. I was playing a tank. He was a wizard. Come here, Justin, I'll heal you with fire! No!
Heal you with fire.
My dwarf
wrong.
Running away across the battlefield going, no, 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 no! And him just dropping AoEs everywhere.
So what are we expecting? Are we going to have, like, when this game's released, are we going to have a lot of set adventures? Or
right, so the plan, obviously, this is very early days, but the plan, and what could possibly go wrong, is we'll have a nice hardback rulebook, mm-hmm. you know, with a nice thick rulebook with lots of information about the quester, the characters, the rules, the equipment, the adventures, the personalities, the stats, you know, Luna and Celestia. Mm-hmm. And so lots of beautiful information presented, you know, in a light style that can be not text heavy, mm-hmm. that, well, relatively not text heavy, certainly not in the league of some other roleplay game, but something that can be enjoyed, even, you know, just a kid maybe will flick through and read some bit. The grown up that has been the game master will probably read most of it. But so basically, nice chunky book of Tales of Equestria, and that will be a self contained buy. So that basically you need just that. So there's photocopyable pony sheets, there's mechanics in the actual game for dice, simulating dice from the pages of the book. So in theory, with just that, you're fine, you don't need anything else. But then, of course, there will be other buys that you can buy. So, for example, obviously, the most obvious... Oh, also, the book will have an initial adventure, kind of an introductory adventure.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And if you're familiar with the series, there's the cutie map, of course, that is kind of a map of Equestria, like a 3D magical map of Equestria, where when there's something that needs the attention of the main characters...
Right.
When I say main, it's spelled M-A-N-E, of course. The map lights up with cutie marks, and basically the map is showing where the trouble is and which pony needs to be dispatched to that mission.
Okay.
And of course, this is a beautiful mechanism that I could use for setting our characters as well on the quest. And so the adventure will be a very basic thing to start for level 1 characters, you know, so to give you an idea in the book. And then later, adventure modules, of course. Mm-hmm. I certainly hope a lot of people will, that have experience in writing roleplay games will get in touch. And you know, if you're interested in the IP and you want to write for this, please get in touch, and we'll you know, we'll send us a synopsis and some of your previous work.
Right. You know. Well, I'm assuming there'll be a link below to the River Horse main website where you can get in touch.
Absolutely, and there will be a Facebook page, and then of course dice, nice colorful dice in the colors that we use for mm-hmm. our games. Then character sheets and all the accessory, the DM screen, you know, all the classic roleplay paraphernalia, really. Mm-hmm. We'll try to do it all.
Right. Are there going to be any miniatures, or is this all going to be a very cerebral role-playing game? Will there be miniatures on the table at any point?
Well, this is a paper project, so mm-hmm. a dice, I guess, I suppose. Okay. But yes, no, we're not making models at all, because clearly the parent company, the OnTableTop, already does quite a lot of PVC figurines and everything. Absolutely, we'll certainly hint at the fact and talk about the fact that it would be cool to have your own character and to play and that on the event. Yes, okay. We are not going to make them, but you know, they are available commercially in quite a quantity.
I want to clear that up, because I know that one of the fans would probably ask that in the comments.
Yes. No, not from us, no, absolutely.
Okay.
The good thing is that I will work out into the role play something to do with the miniatures. I mean, it's an expedient that I always used in all the role plays I ever played in, particularly that I've been a DM in. You know, when you're playing a role play and some of the characters, you know, we're four of us, and then the next time we play, John cannot come.
Yeah.
And there's three of us, and John's character is there, and I kind of go, there's kind of a couple of solutions. No solution ever kind of made work for me, because the solution of, well, John's character, not here, we'll just continue, but he was here a second ago, so that breaks the narrative for me. It's like, well, what did the wizard go? He was here with us. Oh, nobody knows. What wizard? Well, there was with. Then John comes back, next session, and suddenly there's a wizard again. You go,
where were you?
So that never quite satisfied me very much. Mm-hmm. The alternative is to use the other person's character. So you go, right, I have John's wizard, and he does. And but again, that breaks the identification with the character. Suddenly mm-hmm. you have another guy. So it becomes more of a different thing. Mm-hmm. It's me, I'm acting in myself. So I never found either solution particularly interesting. So what I always do is I make sure that the characters in any campaign I run, in the first adventure, they offend some divinity, some great powerful creature that curses them. It goes, mm-hmm. Your curse is at random, at any moment during your life, from now on, you'll be transformed at random into a little miniature statuette version of yourself. Yeah. So basically, for no reason whatsoever, John doesn't turn up, his wizard goes poof, turns into a little statuette. His characters go, oh. So they take him, put him in the buggy, continue the adventure.
Wonderful. Why did you piss off that incredibly powerful being?
When John comes back, suddenly the characters are there, and suddenly you hear this whistle, this very, well, not, it doesn't appear in your bag, that would be, but you suddenly feel the...
I think that would be hilarious, just seeing John's character just half hanging out of the bag, going, kind of
exploding out of your bag.
Help!
Well, I suppose if you leave the miniature there, yes, it would, but basically, alternatively, is it starts to, you know, vibrate, and it's like my mobile phone goes, and the pitch goes up, and you go, quick, put it on the ground, poof, and he's back. So, for me, that... works within the story. That's why John is not playing, because he's into, but which is also is a cute link with the miniature, the thing you use, etc. So there's a kind of a strange relationship there, and I will make sure that certainly will be part of this because it's fun.
Cool. Is there anything else you want to say about this?
Oh, you know, I am hyper excited, and you know, it's terrifying and it's very exciting, and
interaction with main characters, will it happen?
Will
there be much interaction with the main characters?
I don't think there will be much interaction, but certainly some interaction, yes. But again, as I said, it's early days. Those are all things that we need to kind of agree first very well with Hasbro, etc. So, early days. I imagine there will be a little interaction, but certainly not earth-shattering, changing of VIP stuff, because clearly we don't want to do that. It will be low-key stuff, obviously, that doesn't interfere with. But it would be fun to have some interaction, yes, because of course everybody wants to interact with the main characters.
So it might be something along the lines of, oh, I've just picked up a mission off one of them. Okay, off I go.
Absolutely, yeah. Twilight Sparkle, Twilight Map, and goes, I summon you here because your kitty mark appears next to the Evergreen Forest, Everfree Forest, sorry. Go. Maybe it's the Castle of the Two Sisters. You have to go there with the three of you. See, your kitty marks are there. That's it.
I have no idea. All right, well, guys,
that was a good chat about the My Little Pony role-playing game. Surprising.
Tales of Equestria.
Yep. Drop your comments below. What do you think? Is this going to be one that you're going to jump in with your kids? John?
Yes?
Final thoughts?
I'm actually looking forward to giving it a go, and I know tons of people out there that would.
All right.
Mainly because, like, I obviously I'm in that community out there. I'm in the Brony community, so I will be doing Skype DMing, possibly.
Well, like I said, drop your comments below. We're going to tell you about some hubs. We'll see you in a minute.
Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastsofwar.com. Anime cyberpunk style meets skirmish combat in Infinity. Experience 8 high-tech factions and fight to control the human sphere at the Infinity Hub on beastsofwar.com.
Right, so, interesting stuff there, Justin.
I really
Justin.
Enjoyed that chat.
I didn't expect Alessio to be coming out with a My Little Ponies role-playing game.
Ah, but the important thing is, the pony game is going to be fun for him and his daughter,
yes.
Which is what he's really creating it for. Other parents are going to be able to enjoy it with their kids as well. The big thing for me is that Hasbro sticker being on there.
Yes, I think that's the important bit, isn't it?
Well, it's one of the important bits. The game itself is going to be huge because My Little Ponies, it's a big license.
Yes. You
know, it is a massive fan base. People are really going to go after it. But having Hasbro on board is going to open up the door for a lot of other IPs.
All I'm going to say is Transformers!
Not Michael Bay.
Not the Michael Bay one. I want Gen 1!
Original generation cartoon style is
Gen
what I would like to
one
see.
Gen 1 Transformer games.
Alessio, if you're watching this, which I know you probably are, go after that license. Good Lord, it would be amazing.
Ben, what do you think? Gen 1 Transformers. If Hasbro
I would love
were
that, yeah.
in the mood to make miniatures games. Or role-playing games.
Interestingly, I'd be quite interested if they did like a Transformers role-playing game where you made your own Transformer with a cool nickname and you chose what it transformed into and stuff like that. I thought that would be pretty cool.
That could be fun because then you could do the whole crossover with my personal favorite series, which was always Beast Wars.
Yeah.
I've watched Beast Wars.
I was just the right age for it, though.
It was the worst, best kind of CGI. Is
Beast Wars not like in the last 10 years?
No,
it was like mid-90s, I think.
Mid to late 90s,
yeah.
This is the 3D rendered stuff?
Yeah.
I must be really late to the party on that.
Well, I mean, they did two versions of it, because they did the first one, and then they did the Primal one, which was back on Cybertron.
Right, well, all I want is Gen 1. Gen 1!
Honestly, I want it all.
You want it all?
Yeah. I'm a wargamer, I'm greedy, I want it all.
Speaking of wanting it all, there's a hungry people. There are hungry people on Kickstarter wanting more. Well, what's on Kickstarter for these people wanting more?
All right. There's a Kickstarter called Badborn. Now, yes. We actually got some stuff sent in from a company for Eureka, which is a small skirmish game, which they're now bringing an expansion to Kickstarter. So if I bring this up on screen.
Okay.
This is the Badborn Kickstarter, right?
Yes.
The whole concept behind this game is the entire world is now at peace. There is no war, there is no strife.
My God, that sounds boring.
That's the problem. So what they've done is they've created a TV reality game show where the contestants kill each other.
A bit like The Running Man.
A little bit like that, only the contestants are all clones.
Oh.
Now, the problem with cloning is it's quite complicated, right? So once in a while, something's going to go wrong and you're going to end up with a, unfortunately, malformed clone. But, waste not, want not, we now have the new contestants, which are zombies, which have been let loose to actually kill, maim, destroy, absolutely wreak havoc.
Yes.
And you have some very, very cool stuff going on. You've got, look at some of the boards we're seeing here. Really dense terrain, really nicely made up for your game shows.
That's kind of a surprise, because I guess it's that Hunger Games game show thing. Because I originally thought WWE. If you watch the video, you'll come away thinking WWE.
Oh no! Because there is the exclusive miniature. This dude.
Oh yes, let's bring this up.
So can you tell me his name, like?
Keeper.
Ben's already done it. Ben, he stole my line.
Stole his thunder. Yeah.
Put some effort into it, Ben.
The Grave Keeper.
Oh man, that was far better. Oh.
That's far better.
I've got the lungs for
it. I'm not even going to try now. Yeah, so I got that WWE vibe from it. Yeah. So if we scroll back up, I'm kind of surprised to see the whole dongle thing, and
it's a TV show. Yeah. So it can be set anywhere. You know. Oh look, this week we're in the sci-fi zone. You know, that kind of stuff. Really cheesy movie stuff.
A bit like the Crystal Maze.
Yeah.
I was about to say.
Oi! I see what you did there.
Yeah, your boldness reminded me.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, come along, my darlings.
Yes, come on through to the Amazon zone.
Oh, we're going to the Amazon zone. Mumsy would be so proud.
No, no, you're too good at that. Stop it.
Oh, boss.
Oh, I've had too much sugar today. I'm kind of hyperactive on camera.
So,
sorry.
This is an existing game. What they're funding here is an expansion for the zombies.
Yeah, so the whole idea is, in the world, the TV show's ratings are dipping a little bit. Yeah. So how do we make it better? Let's add in some zombies, you know. So every single character is actually getting a zombie variant of themselves. Ah, and this is one you'll like. They're actually doing a gaming mat as well.
Yeah, if you scroll up.
Yeah.
I was having a look down this. I enjoyed the video immensely because it's just, it's so 1980s extreme.
Yeah, you're kind of getting the old WWE. And here we are, it's Hulk Hogan!
I kind of just giggled through it and I was like, the whole... Do you want metal? And I was like, yeah, I want metal!
Look, guys,
do you want more? Yeah, I want more!
I will say this. Go pause this video and go watch the video. It is quite funny.
But as I was scrolling down...
Yeah, all of a sudden...
The sad sack in me spotted little terrain pieces and
that's
awesome!
Not sad, because it's little incidental pieces like this that really set off a gaming tale. Bring this up big for me.
Yeah.
Because I want to actually have a look at some of these. So we've got stuff to actually make a bar. We've got all of our wall segments. We've got trash bins and standard barrels and stuff, but then they're doing a gaming mat as well. This is going to let you make a really epic gaming board without much effort.
Yes, I was admiring the mat, thinking it's sort of pretty mat. It's the year of the mat continued, Ben.
No,
it is continued.
It's not continued.
The thing that I really liked about this is the fact that it's a game that is coming out of the blocks with that kind of scattered terrain and that sort of cinematic feel to it.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, all the characters look like they've come out of like an anime or a Hollywood film. And then to add in the actual set dressing, as it were, with all the terrain that comes with it, means that this is actually probably quite a fun game to get stuck into and just have a bit of fun with. It feels a little bit like the kind of fun you'd have from a game like 7TV, where you don't take it too seriously. You have a little bit of fun with it. There's some crazy, kooky objectives mixed in there as well. And obviously now the Badborn thing comes in with all the zombies. Everybody likes zombies. So yeah, I think it'd be really cool. Yeah.
It is looking good. Go back up to the scatter pieces there, Justin.
Oh, the scatter terrain, yeah?
Yeah, because we can have a quick look at them on screen. But even better than that...
Yeah, the guys actually sent us through some of the stuff.
It was awesome. I was admiring them there before we came into film, and then Justin walked in. Oh, you like that? And I was like, yeah. And he goes,
I have them sitting here.
Here they are!
Yeah, well, actually, I tell you what, the first thing I want to show off is...
Let's do the scatter pieces.
All right.
We'll come to the minis.
You can tell that Lloyd's on a show when he looks at the terrain first before the miniatures.
No, I will say, they have done a really nice job of these. And if you are looking for incidental pieces for your table, these are perfect because they're not branded.
Yes.
You get what I mean? So if I pop these down...
Use them for anything.
You've got three really nice trash bins.
And people at home might be thinking... You're getting excited about a bin. But one of the things...
How often do you actually find a decent bin to put on your table that you're not having to make yourself?
They're stupidly difficult to come by.
Yeah.
And the best thing is, once you've got terrain like this sitting down, let me just get it on the camera. I mean, immediately, we've got so many places to sit and run from.
Yeah. Let's see. I believe this is a wardrobe.
Yeah, let's get this up close.
Ah, one of my personal favorites. You have a slot machine.
Is this a wardrobe? Oh, it is.
Yeah.
This is what I'm liking. The vending machines.
Yeah, you've got the bar.
Yeah.
You've got a big cooler.
As we're showing these off, Ben, are these...
You get a little water cooler.
Oh, that's cool. Are these part of stretch goals? Well, they exist. Are these rewards and stuff that you depend on the package?
These are add-ons.
Yeah, you can get them as add-ons as part of the pledges, because the main pledge itself is looking towards sort of the starter sets, the exclusive miniature and things like that, which all come sort of packaged together in like these VHS style cases. But the terrain and stuff are sort of add-ons and extra bonuses to the pledges that you can put in there as well. Same with the mats and things as well. So,
yeah. Real cool stuff.
Yeah.
Right, Justin, you've been sitting, getting more
stuff out because you get an absolute ton with it. So, first up, I love these old school retro video game consoles. old quarter droppers.
They're just class.
You even get a pinball machine. You get your dartboard.
Yeah.
And look, you even get a pool table. How many games have you ever wanted to put a pool table into a bar but not had a pool table?
Yes. Which give me that back. Give me that back.
Yes.
Which unfortunately Numpty here dropped.
I
dropped just before we started filming.
I have the leg here, I'll fix it off camera.
Oh, oh dear. The most exciting bit, the pool table. And you dropped it.
Even I have Warren moments.
Right. What else then, Dustin? I see we have minis and stuff.
Yeah,
what
we have minis. The minis that are across by you are the actual ones that the guys are kickstarting.
Yes.
Now, I love this one, which is
the Gravekeeper.
Yeah, which comes on a really nice scenic base with a grave or a coffin on it.
Yeah.
That and the detail on this guy is really cool. Look at how delicate that hat rim actually is.
That is actually pretty sharp.
They've got some insanely cool detail on them, eh? Then you've got all of the different characters, a la zombie. And this little guy who's like a mad scientist actually has his backpack exploding. So you'll be fit to paint some really cool flame effects onto that.
Yeah, we've seen him on the page as we were scrolling down.
Yeah, you then have, of course, the ever-needed zombie dog. And then this guy in the actual game has a big biomimetic arm. But because he's, you know, dead, rotting flesh, it's actually fallen off. So you'll be able to paint some really nice gore effects on these.
Cool stuff.
I'm really looking forward to seeing this Kickstarter complete. I'm actually going to be having a closer look because we actually have the starter set with the base game in here as well.
Okay, so the Kickstarter's not for this. The Kickstarter's
no, this is what's already
for
out,
this.
But I wanted to show this off because this is essentially the first starter set you'll get for this game.
Okay.
Everything you need in this.
Just that one little box.
In this
okay,
one little box.
There.
Let me put it in here. So, if I crack this open, you've got all your tokens and stuff. You've got this card, which is actually your ID for any tournaments you go to. You can actually keep a record of your wins and losses.
Okay.
That's the size of the rulebook. That's all the rules for the game. So, if I actually find a page here. There you go. All your stats for one of your characters. Your
Sweet.
Contestants. Beneath that, you've got few little bits of terrain, so just some nice little barrels to add.
Yeah.
All your miniatures and a full set of dice to play the game. All in one package. Absolutely perfect.
I like this. That is really sweet, Ben. You can't really see it, but it's such a tidy package here. And again...
Yeah, it's a nice little set.
And it's a use for your old VHS boxes.
Yes.
it is like a VHS box. It's cute. It's in keeping with their video.
Yeah.
It's 80s style, yeah.
Yeah.
but even in that, they already gave you some barrels and stuff.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. So you can really start building some cool terrain. We have one other box here. Now, yes. I believe this is sort of what we're aiming for at the end of this Kickstarter.
Okay.
So this, if I open it up, has all of the miniatures that the guys are actually trying to Kickstarter right now.
Are these zombies we're looking at?
These are all the zombie miniatures. And you can see there's a ton of them. You also get some nice green dice along with it, which I think is really cool. So, I don't know. I like this Kickstarter. I think it's one people should go check out.
It's looking
you know
sweet.
Me, I love my zombies.
Yeah, and they're pretty close to being fully funded at this point in filming.
Yep,
they probably are by now.
And they're coming close to the end of the run on Kickstarter. So if you're going to have a look at it, now's the time.
Okay, excellent stuff.
Yeah, so
next?
If I still have it open here, which I do, is one that really has me excited.
Yes.
We have War Tile. So we have a digital tabletop game.
What do you mean, digital tabletop game?
I mean, look at the gaming table that we're seeing here.
Right. It looks like a diorama.
It looks like a digital game. So look at it.
All right.
If I can find... Yes, look. So they've done a digital tabletop game, but it's different to all the other ones that are out there.
Right, because it's not flat for a start.
Yeah, and it's hex-based, but it's not turn-based. It's also not true real-time.
Ah, what is it, Justin?
It's a mix of all of it together.
No, it's not, Ben. Because, right, one thing I hear about tabletop games being transferred to the digital format is whenever it's the other person's turn, you're completely non-engaged. You're disconnected. You might as well go away, make a cup of tea. Yeah?
Yeah.
In this, you have a cooldown on your miniatures as you actually move them around the board. So it's not true real-time where I can just tell my miniature, right, I want you to go all the way over there and attack that base.
Okay.
I have to constantly be managing each of my units as if I was on a tabletop.
Okay.
But I have to wait a little while before activating them again. So instead
right.
of having that full stop, other person's turn, you have, okay, I have to go elsewhere on the board. Okay, he's doing stuff, you're ready again, off we go. So it really makes you multitask as you're playing the game, which is a really nice effect.
So it's not as fast-paced as full-on real-time.
But it keeps you on your toes because you're not doing as much.
But it is real-time, in so much as you will always have something to be moving.
You will always have something to be moving, but you're not just telling it to go and do a job. You're constantly managing stuff yourself.
Yeah.
This does sound cool because I used to be big into my RTSs on the PC and stuff.
Yeah.
But as I got older and older and older, I was like, oh my god, there's too much stuff happening. I can't keep a track of this.
Let me guess, you hit Supreme Commander and just went, wait, what? Well, I'm activating, okay, 200 guys here, 100 guys there, northern, southern attack at the same time. What's going on?
Supreme Commander wasn't, it was like, I tried it once and said, no.
Actually, it's on Xbox Live at the minute, if you like, grab it for yourself.
I might try it again and just, and juice up on loads of Red Bulls and go, right, kiddies, I'm gonna get ya! That sounds really bad.
Welcome back, Lloyd. Welcome back.
It sounded awful.
Honestly, but I think this is a really cool game.
But my point is, I kind of like what you're saying. I like the sound of it being a more... Yes, you're playing all the time, but it's not frantic
play. Yeah, you have time to think as stuff cools down and time to plan your attacks. Also, the computer doesn't instantly come after you.
All right,
you have to get within a range of it before its units notice you.
This brings me to the point, right? So we've talked a little bit about how the game plays.
Yeah.
What is the point of the game? Let's say, right, let's compare it to XCOM, which is another really cool digital game.
Basically, you are a Viking warlord.
I mean, right, so am I attacking the computer or am I attacking other players?
You're attacking the computer, but there will also be multiplayer aspects to it. But one of my favorite aspects, if you bring up the screen here, look at this. You actually have little bases on your miniatures, but you can re-equip your guys. So yeah, I can pick different shield, different helmet, different cloak and stuff.
Yeah.
So I can make my Viking warband my own.
So it is a bit like miniature gaming on digital.
Yeah, yeah. I'm really looking forward to see where it's going, you know.
There's a card-based element to it as well, I think isn't there, Justin? The way to use a hand of cards, yeah?
That's the magic for this game.
Right.
You know, so as you kill stuff, you'll generate points for your magic usage.
Yes.
Now, the thing's still in alpha, so it has a lot of ways to go. But once you actually have enough of the magic resource, you actually play cards in your hand, so you can call down Lightning of the Gods, play global heals, do shield walls and stuff.
Okay.
Oh, you know, right.
So it's a very, very cool tactical game. I'm looking forward to it.
So there's about 13, 14 days, something like that, left to go on this?
At the time of filming... There is about 13 days, yeah.
Yeah, and what are they actually trying to fund here?
The game itself.
Can you bring it up there just as we have one last look at the screen?
So here's how combat works in it. You're seeing in this little GIF here.
Yeah.
So you're seeing two guys, some of them have reach, others don't. And then the actual color on the base is actually your health bar. So it'll shrink as you take damage.
Oh, that's kind of
neat. Which is really cool.
Yeah.
Then you have all your different classes as well.
Yeah, I mean, as Justin was saying, I think the main aim of this is at the moment is to fund the game, but also it's the first campaign, which is all about fighting for control of Scandinavia and England and things like that during the with these slightly fantastical Vikings and things. So yeah, should be cool. Up my alley. Vikings are great. So yeah,
I'm seeing some really nice looking tables.
Yeah,
I'm describing them as tables because I guess that's the closest approximation to what they are, because they've gone down this very miniature-looking route.
Yeah, I really like it. And then here's the magic that we were talking about.
Yeah.
So you actually build your deck as you want for your magic. It's a really, really cool thing. I'm really looking forward to it. It's one of those things. I'm still a digital gamer as well as a tabletop gamer, so this one kind of hits close to my heart. You know.
And are they funded? We're close to funding.
I'm not sure.
Let's go right up to the page and find out.
Sorry if anyone gets a little sick from the fast scrolling here.
they are about.
They are.
They're about halfway.
Yeah.
Yeah. Halfway.
But they're about halfway through their Kickstarter as well. Yeah.
They do need a little bit of help. So if that's of interest to you, jump on there and help them out. Yeah. Right.
I believe that's us.
That was a busy week.
Oh, it's been a crazy week.
Right. If you've enjoyed the show, remember there is the backstage version tomorrow, which is a whole new episode of this show. Every week we do a front stage show and a backstage show, and the backstage show is open to those who support Beasts of War and help us do what we do.
Yeah.
So, if you've enjoyed it, come on over to beastsofwar.com, sign up, and hopefully we'll see you tomorrow.
Progress comes to a world of magic as science and the arcane combine to make marvels. Meet steampunk inventors and orc mystics at the Volsung Hub on beastsofwar.com.
keep your blaster handy, the West is a dangerous place. Fight to survive as men turn to monsters and the dead rise on the Wild West Exodus Hub at beastofwar.com.